Hello everyone. Now today let us discuss one culture theory. As I told you earlier, this is a very important part in anthropology, a very important topic in anthropology. Chapter number 6 in paper 1. Anthropological theories. Earlier we have discussed about classical evolutionism by E.B. Taylor, Lewis Henry Morgan, James Frazer, etc. Then we have also discussed about diffusionism, in which we have discussed about the British school of diffusion and the German school of diffusion. And we are yet to do the American school of diffusion by Clark Bisler, Alfred Kroeber, etc. We have read historical particularism, functionalism, structural functionalism, and also culture and personality. So today let us discuss one very important theory, that is symbolic and interpretive theories. Symbolic and interpretive theories. Symbolic and interpretive theories, in which we will be discussing about the contribution of Clifford Geertz, Victor Turner and Schneider. So what do you mean by symbolic, being symbolic and interpretive? In our day-to-day life, we use a variety of symbols. And these symbols are meant for communication. Communication. So if somebody comes to meet me in the morning, they will say, if they are traditional person, if they are from village, they will say namaskar. There is both a verbal and a non-verbal communication here. You say namaskar, that is a verbal communication. Even the language which we speak is a symbol only. Apart from this, see, he makes some gesture, keeping the hand like this. Again, this is a symbol. And this symbol needs to be interpreted properly. Somebody write, we come to you, without saying namaskar, simply will say, it means he is greeting you. If you go and do this to somebody in Samoa Island, they'll think, what this guy is doing? Why he is keeping his hand like this? Is he hiding anything inside this? Or is he carrying any knife in that which he will throw it on us? Why he is keeping his hand like this? People in Samoa are a bushman from Kalahari Desert, he will not be in a position to interpret this symbol. You have made a symbol, he is not in a position to interpret. He will simply say, what are you doing? And many a times, right, as you are preparing for your personality, as you are preparing for this IAS examination, I tell you, many people have their anxiety about the personality test. Sir, what they are asking that, what they are, sir, I have heard that for one particular student, they asked about quantum computing. Sir, I don't know about quantum computing, how I can answer? They asked that guy about quantum computing means, huh? He should be from that particular field. It doesn't mean that to become an IAS or to appear before the board in UPSC, one should not know that one should know everything beneath the sky. That is not always possible. So here, and it doesn't mean that they are going to give you marks based on your correct answers. It is just a purposeful conversation where they will just look into your personality, your attitude, your values, etc. And your marks will be based on that and not certainly based on the number of correct answers which you give in your personality test. See, there is a saying that once when you enter your interview hall, try to greet your members, try to greet your board's chairman and the members verbally. Do not raise your hand and say good morning. Because they say in few part of our own country, raising a hand like this is a wrong signal. People may interpret that in a different way. Okay, so symbols are meant for communication and people can understand the symbol only when they are part of that culture, and only when they understand what these symbols are, people will be in a position to interpret that. There are number of symbols which we do. For example, in South India, in a traditional Hindu marriage, the boy or the groom will tie a thread in the neck of the bride, the nuptial thread. It will be yellow in color. They'll just tie that, the boy will tie that in the head of, or the neck of the girl. This is a symbol. One need to interpret what he is doing. It means he is getting married. That means now they both can now form a family and they both are meant for each other and they can start a new life, establish a family, go for procreation, get babies, etc. And if somebody is not in a position to understand this, for example, it happened in South Africa. When Gandhiji was there, we know that he launched a movement for the native people and the migrant Indians there against the British there. Once the South African British government declared that only the marriages which were conducted as per the Christian laws, as per the Christian way, are considered as marriage. If you just tie a nuptial knot, we cannot call this as a marriage. You come to church and exchange the rings, then only it becomes a marriage. That means they are not ready to accept your symbol. They are not ready to interpret your symbol. Interpret your symbol. So there are in a variety of ways in our day-to-day life, not just in our day-to-day life, even in our political life, even in warfare, we use a number of symbols. Number of symbols. I'll give you one good example for symbols used in warfare. This is one scene from the movie Troy. A very fantastic movie which was made. The story was a Trojan War. Iliad and Odyssey. I think you may be knowing this, right? The great epics made by the Greek philosopher, Greek poet, Iliad and Odyssey, which deals with the Trojan War. So this is one scene from that movie. Here they make a symbol. The symbol here is hitting a bell or knocking a bell, and that bell symbol is a symbol for war. Even in India, we have a number of symbols. In every single fort, a huge drums will be kept there in some corner, and the way in which the drums are blown, right, that gives a symbol that yes, it is a war time. And when people hear that particular beating such a way, They just throw whatever they have and they'll run and they'll get ready for the battle. Some enemy had invaded our territory. So we need to run for the battle, we need to run for fighting. So symbol instigates action. So in our everyday life, right, we deal with symbols. And according to this school of thought, it is the symbols, right, which plays a major role in expressing the culture. We can understand the culture from the symbols which people use in their day-to-day life. Symbols carry the culture. If you say symbols are vehicles of culture, symbols carry the culture. If you say symbols act or play a major role in everyday life, symbols instigate social action. So let us discuss about this school of thought now. Symbolic and interpretive theories. In this, right, we are going to study the contribution of three great anthropologists. Three great anthropologists. One is Clifford Geertz. Clifford Geertz of Chicago University. And his approach is a symbolic approach. Symbolic is a bit important. Try to note down. Symbolic. His approach is symbolic. There are two school of thought inside this itself. One deals with the symbols. Another one deals with the interpretation of symbols. Okay. So his approach is symbolic approach. The next is the Victor Turner of Cornell University. Victor Turner of Cornell University. Victor Turner of Cornell University, and his approach is the interpretive approach. His interpretive approach. And next comes David Schneider. David Schneider and his approach, right? We cannot just group it into one category. Okay, group it into one category. So keep this in mind. Even we will not go in deep into what exactly you mean by symbolism and what exactly you mean by interpretive theories. But if they ask you about symbolic approach, it is Clifford Geertz, and the interpretive approach means it is Victor Turner. Okay, so now let us discuss what these theories are. And keep in mind, these theories, right, developed as a negative reaction to the structuralism or the structural theory given by Lévi-Strauss. So according to Lévi-Strauss, culture is locked in a human's head. So culture is what we think from inside our head. So culture is locked in our human's head. So we will discuss in length about Lévi-Strauss' theory of structuralism. Now just remember that these theories developed as a negative reaction to Lévi-Strauss' theory of structuralism. So according to them, culture is expressed in symbols and it is not locked inside our human head. See, first they say their assumption is, there are two important assumptions in this theory. Number one, beliefs, however unintelligible. See here, beliefs. This is the first important assumption. That is, belief, however unintelligible. Unintelligible means it is very tough to understand, or it is very hard to understand what exactly that is. Very tough to understand what exactly it is. So beliefs, however unintelligible, it becomes comprehensive when understood as a part of cultural system of meaning. I'll tell you one example for this. So there are some beliefs which we cannot understand why they are doing it. What is there in this? Why they are placing a lot of value on this particular belief? So we may not be in a position to understand that. But once, when you understand that, once when you think that as a part of a cultural system, then you will get the meaning for that. I'll tell you one good example for this. In South India, there is one belief. The towel which people in villages keep over their shoulder. There is too much of a prestige associated with the towel. And there are many things, there are many stories, or there are many important ethos or many important belief about this towel which they are keeping it. Lot of power and prestige is associated with that. Along with that, there are a lot of belief also. In villages, right, as a part of establishing a guilt, they used to do. If somebody is not accepting that he did the crime, then they will ask them, you are not accepting the crime, right? Then take your towel. Place it in the floor. You keep your You spread your towel in the floor and you cross this. You walk over the towel and now you tell that you didn't do that crime, that you didn't hit that woman, or you didn't do the rape. You tell now. Well, they will so hesitate to tell a lie after crossing a towel. For an outsider, right, they may think, what is this belief? If he is so reluctant to tell, let him walk over there and tell. What's going to happen because of walking over it? That is just a small piece of cloth, right? Walking over that, how it is going to harm? But it is a belief, right? For outsiders, we cannot understand what exactly is the belief in that. But one thing is for sure, when you understand this as a part of the social system, these are the things, which are created within the society to create some sort of social order. People were made to believe that if you do that, it will harm them. It is a belief in the system. By making the people to believe, they are in a position to establish some social order. So this is a symbol. So this symbol, right, however it is unintelligible, if we understand this as a part of cultural system, it becomes comprehensible. It gets the meaning. So this is the first assumption of this theory. Beliefs, however unintelligible, it becomes comprehensible when understood as a part of a cultural system of meaning. Cultural system of meaning. Then the next assumption is, actions are guided by interpretations. by material activities here, we mean by the materials. Take a knife and cut a person, take a knife and cut a goat. The material activities. By ideal activities here, this refers to our faith, our belief, our values. Okay, here they are saying actions are guided by interpretations. So this allows symbolism to aid in interpreting ideal as well as material activities. So actions are guided by interpretations. So if there is a symbol, right, somebody need to interpret so that some action can follow that. I'll tell you some example. In a cricket match, if an umpire raises his hand like this, it means it is a wicket, and the batsman who is out need to vacate the crease, allowing the next batsman to come in. Cricket is a gentleman's game, and even if it is not a perfect wicket, even if there is a doubt, batsman should give respect to the umpire and he need to vacate the crease. But sometimes it will not happen. Even few times when Sachin Tendulkar, right, he used to express anguish. No, many a times, right, during his earlier part of career. But he's a thorough gentleman. That's a different thing. He was caught behind some two or three times and he used to express his anguish. No. He just, the bat leg used to go. Our great Sourav Ganguly, great player of our Indian cricket team, once, right, he was out while batting. He continued to stay there in the crease. Looking at him staying there, right, umpire even raised his hand. Still, right, he was standing there thinking something. Then after some 20 seconds, right, he just started walking out of the crease. He didn't express any anger against the umpire for the decision, because that is not an LPW or caught behind. It was a clean bolt. He was shocked by the delivery and he stood there. Oh my God, what happened? How did the ball go and hit the steps? Okay. See, actions are interpreted, or actions are guided by interpretation. So one need to walk out means, after seeing the symbol, you need to interpret, yes, I am out and I need to walk out. So this allows us in interpreting the ideal as well as the material activities. Actions are guided by interpretations. So now let us discuss about the Clifford Greed zone. See, before that, it's a traditionally, right, or symbolic anthropologists, that they dealt with religion, cosmology, ritual activity, and expressive customs. Most of the time, right, 99% our symbolic and interpretive theories deals with these expressive customs, like saying namaskar, it's an expressive custom. Okay, fine then. Clifford Greeds, a great anthropologist, died recently. A great anthropologist of Chicago University. He was influenced by a number of thinkers, and whatever work he did, right, he compiled that into paper called as, into an essay called as, The Interpretation of Cultures. interpretation of culture. In that right, he believed that culture, right, it should not be an experimental science in the search of love. It should not be an experimental science in search of love. It should not be. But it should be an interpretive one in search of meaning. So while studying culture, right, we should not look for laws in culture. Instead, right, we should look for in search of meaning. Culture should be an interpretive one in search of meaning, and it's not an experimental science where one should look for a law. I'll give you one example. If someone gets married to a girl, what is going to happen to him? How long that marriage is going to last? Whether he is going to live with the same girl lifelong, or whether he is going to divorce that girl and get married to somebody else, or just having her as his wife, whether this guy is going to bring one more girl. We cannot make a law here, because once when you make a law, 1 plus 1 is equal to 2. That is a law. Even if you do it 1000 times, right, we'll get the same answer only. That is a law. Excuse me. That is a law. But here, we are not here to search a law, because it won't happen always in culture. It won't always happen in culture. We make some codified rules or laws or patterned behavior, but we cannot expect everyone to follow the same pattern throughout the life. There will be deviations. So what we are going to study here is, so study of culture should be an interpretive one in understanding the meaning. Okay, he is getting married, right? Okay, that means they are going to start a life. Hopefully everything is fine. They may live together for a long time. Let us wish them 100 years of married life. That's what we can understand. That's what we can interpret from the symbols. And here, right, we can just know the meaning. What exactly is the meaning of this act? Why they are doing it? So they are getting married, right? What does it mean? We are not here in search of laws, because laws will not always work in culture. Got it? So according to him, study of culture is not an experimental one in finding a law, but it should be an interpretive one in finding or searching the meaning. Okay, fine. Next, according to him, culture is expressed in symbols. Culture is expressed in symbols. And he gives one definition for culture. According to him, culture is an historically definition for culture. According to him, culture is a historically transmitted patterns of meaning. Patterns of meaning embodied in symbols. Culture is a historically transmitted pattern of meanings embodied in symbols. See, when you say in a marriage, if somebody ties a nuptial knot, or somebody makes a girl to wear a ring in her finger, it is one symbol, correct? It is a symbol. There is a meaning for the symbol. This symbol can be interpreted. And the meaning for this symbol, right, will be transmitted historically, generation after generation. It doesn't mean that in one generation wearing a ring means getting married. In the next generation, they will make, just like in Raksha Bandhan, what we do. the girls will tie the Rakhi in the hand of their brother. That is a symbol. That is a symbol. It means that this girl is being protected by her brother. But a boy wearing a ring or making or wearing a ring in the finger of a girl in the church. Almost a similar act, but that is a marriage. So in one generation, right, we cannot interpret the symbol like in one generation, right? If they make up wearing a ring as a marriage and Rakhi as a symbol of brotherhood, brother-sister relationship. And in the next generation, if they change this, right, no, it won't work. So historically transmitted for few generations, right? Maybe this the act of Raksha Bandhan was popularized by Rabindranath Tagore and a few other national leaders during the national movement. But still it is celebrated as a festival in our country. And through historical period, right, tying a Rakhi in the hand of a boy means there is a meaning for that. One can, at least in India, we can interpret that. We can interpret that, correct? So historically we are doing it. These symbols, right, are transmitted generation after generation, and these symbols carry a meaning. So that's what they say. According to Clifford Creed's, culture is an historically transmitted pattern of meaning embodied in symbols. In symbols. Then, so according to Clifford Creed's, symbols are vehicles of culture. This is one thing you understand or do not understand. You need to mention this in your answer. Culture is, according to him, is symbols are vehicles of culture. What vehicles will do? It will carry us from one place to another. Here these symbols, it carries the culture across generation from grand-grandfather to grand-grandkids, and it keeps going. So here the symbols, right, it carries the culture across generations. So according to Clifford Creed's, symbols are the vehicles of culture. So keep in mind these two things, at least try to remember, at least three things. When you write about Clifford Creed's, first important thing is he compiled all his work into an essay called as The Interpretation of Culture. First you need to remember. Next, right, according to him, so culture should not be an experimental science in search of law, but it should be an interpretive one in search of meaning. Do not look for laws in culture. Look for meaning in the culture. Try to interpret the symbols and understand the meaning in that. Do not make laws here always. Next is, according, he gives a definition for culture. Culture is a historically transmitted pattern of meaning embodied in symbols. Then according to him, symbols are vehicles of culture. These four things, right? Just mark it and keep it in your mind. So I'll tell you even how to remember or recollect the things. I'll tell you shortly, okay? Then after this, right, see, so Clifford Creed's, right, he was largely interested in the way in which symbols shape the way that social actors feel, see, and think about the world. And think about the world. Then after this, Clifford Creed speaks about two important things, thick description and a thin description. He classifies the symbols into two types. One is thick description. And the other one is thin description. Thick description, another one is thin description. So these concepts that he borrowed from Gilbert Ryle. Gilbert Ryle. where he discusses about he gives a very good example for thick description and thin description, winking and blinking. Blink and wink. You might have heard recently this Priya Warrior, Kerala actress, she had created a huge news by her act of winking. It's not
1.5 crore Indians make up the car, bike, health, or travel insurance daily. Digit Krishna.
Let's do the digit dance. Let's do the digit show dance. Let's do the
thing. Maybe I'll share it some other time. Okay. So, blinking means somebody does. That's a blinking. So we blink many a time because sometimes, right, without our knowledge, dust may come and fall in our eyes. To protect the sight, we may be blinking. Blinking is an involuntary activity that happens without our knowledge. Without our knowledge, we keep doing it. And this is not a symbol. It will not carry any meaning. It does not carry any meaning. So these are small acts. These are like symbols. But this will not carry any meaning. If somebody blinks, right, it's not a big meaning. On the other hand, if somebody winks, just like this, that's a winking, right? This is a conspiracy act. Suppose if it is a meeting of your goons, they may have some communication that if I just wink like this, you start firing at them. So winking is a conspiracy signal. This has some communication value. This communicates some meaning. This, according to him, is a thick description. Got it? So thick description means these are some voluntary activities which we do using our body parts, which carry some meaning. On the other hand, blinking is a thin description. A thin description does not carry a huge meaning. Huge meaning. So apart from this, right, there are few things which we need to discuss. So now I tell you, so what are the things we need to remember about Clifford Greed's interpretive theories? First and foremost important thing is, in symbolic and interpretive theories, this is a symbolic theory. This approach is symbolic. His approach is symbolic. Symbolic approach, first thing which we need to remember. Then number two is book. Interpretation of culture. Next, what he says about symbolic interpretive theories. According to him, culture, in culture, right, one should not be, culture is not an experimental science in search of laws, but it is an interpretive one in search of meaning. Then we need to remember his definition for culture: historically transmitted pattern of, okay, historically transmitted pattern of meanings. Historically transmitted pattern of meanings embodied in symbols. Then fifth thing which we need to remember is, according to him, according to culture, so symbols are vehicles of culture. Then sixth, we need to discuss about his thick and thin description. According to them, culture is not locked inside the head, but culture is expressed through symbols. So suppose if they ask you about symbolic and interpretive theories, in that if they just ask you to write about, write a brief note on the symbolic approach in a symbolic in study of culture, symbolic approach in study of culture. We need to write about Clifford Greeds and these points. And can you make it for some 250 words? Your answer will be a very fantastic answer then. So these are the things which we need to remember. So while revising also, right, how you revise someday when you are not doing anthropology. For 2 days, right, continuously if you are reading geography or Indian economy. Suddenly sometime, right, you may get some free time or you may just wait there in your dining table waiting for your mom to serve food. In the time, what you can do? Yeah, I read symbolic and interpretive theories, right? Is it possible for me to recollect Clifford Greed's theory of interpretation of culture? So there should be 6 points, right, which you need to remember. Try to remember now. So out of 6, right, you may be in a position to remember some 3 or 4, some 2 may be missing. What is that one which is missing? Oh God, there will be some definition for culture, right? Culture is a historically transmitted pattern of symbols, or culture is a historically transmitted pattern of meaning embodied in symbol. I forget that, right? Okay. So like that, you need to remember. So you may be remembering some 4 or 4, and you may not be in a position to remember 2. Keep thinking for some time until you eat, right? What is that? What is that? I'm not able to recollect that. And once when you finish dining, go take your book and see. Oh, these are the 2 I missed it. Then this will very easily stick into your mind. You can also make some mnemonic to remember all these things. I hope you are comfortable with the symbolic approach given by Clifford Greeds. Alright, now let us discuss his yet another contribution. This is something very important. So in the book Interpretation of Culture, he mentions about one very important thing. He was there in Indonesia. He was there in a Muslim dominated society where people were a bit so reluctant to accept him as a guest. He couldn't penetrate the society. He couldn't mix with them. He couldn't drink and dance with them. What to study these people? He wrote a very famous thing, Deep Play, the notes on Deep Play. The notes on the Balinese cockfight. Deep Play, notes on the Balinese cockfight. So what he did here, he was there in Indonesia, he and his wife. But they couldn't penetrate these local people. The local people always viewed him with some sort of suspicion, and he couldn't mix with the local people. Here in Indonesia, cockfight is very, very common. Cockfight is a fight between 2 cocks, 2 hen, not hen, cock, the male form, right? And it is just a fight between 2 birds. They'll just tie some blade sometimes, or sometimes they both will be allowed to fight, in which, right, they'll be just flying, fighting, flying and fighting, and one will lose the battle, dying, falling down and dying. This cockfight is common in most of the tropical areas, in most of the tropical places. Even in India, right, in South India, it is something very common. In Africa, it is common, but in most of the countries, the cockfight has become illegal. The government has outlawed or banned this particular fight. Because wherever it happens, it is not just a fight between 2 birds, but there are too much of symbols associated with this cockfight. There is too much of prestige behind this cockfight. Generally, right, in villages, the great village people, the village head or somebody next to him, right? They will be indulging in this cockfight. And for that, they will be training a number of cocks. They will be providing them a lot of nutritious food. And if they lose in this fight, right, it is a loss of prestige here. It is not considered as a just game. Their prestige, their power, everything gets associated, get intertwined in this particular process. And there will be too much of betting behind this. It is not just in thousands or lakhs. Sometimes people even bet their own property. Sometimes they bet their own people, own family members. As a result, right, there will always be a lot of conflict associated with this cockfight, killing the people, murder. There was one Tamil movie made after this cockfight. This actor Dhanush and Tapsi Pannu. I think that was the first movie of Tapsi Pannu, second movie I think of Tapsi Pannu. And that movie got a national award. A fantastic movie about this cockfight. Okay, it was outlawed. And once, right, there was a cockfight which Clifford Greaves was watching along with his wife. When that was going on, right, police somehow got some idea about this cockfight going on. This came in good numbers and they started beating the people and they all started running for their life. In this process, even Clifford Greaves and his wife, they also ran and they took shelter in the courtyard of one local guy. By this process, right, so until now they thought he is a white man, he is from Clifford Greaves, he is from US, he is an American. Okay, we should not just speak everything about us to this guy. They were so reluctant to accept him as a member of the society. But because of this act, right, they thought, hey, he is also one like us. See, he also got beating from the police. He is just taking shelter among us. So by this process, right, he managed to penetrate that population. He managed to study them. He managed to interview them. He managed to mix with them. And he wrote this very famous article in the paper, Deep Play, the Notes on Balinese Cockfight. Okay. In fact, Bali, right, this is a Hindu majority territory of Indonesia. Most of the people were Hindus only. Still, he couldn't manage to penetrate them easily. Did fine. Next is Victor Turner. So by deep play, Greed speaks about the quantum of cultural aspects associated with the symbols. It is not just a small symbol, this fighting of these birds, a small symbol it is. But there is too much of cultural value behind this. This is what he terms as a deep play. Deep play. Okay, fine. So now let us discuss the contribution of next anthropologist, Victor Turner. Turner of Cornell University. And make sure his approach is an interpretive one. His approach is interpretive approach. Something very, very important. If they ask you to write about the interpretive approach in symbolic theories, you need to write about Victor Turner's approach. So actually write down. Even he was earlier influenced by the British school of structural functionalism. But during his study among the Nedumbu tribe of Africa, his focus right turned from economics and demography to ritual symbolism. ritual symbolism. So according to Victor Turner, symbols, right? According to him, symbols are not vehicles of culture, but symbols are operators in social process. Symbols are operators in the social process.